Hi, everybody. My name is Maria Elena Gutierrez. I am the director of the VIEW Conference here in beautiful Turin, Italy. Well, I want to welcome our very special guests. We are delighted to have a very special panel today. We will be talking to a group of amazing human beings, legendary VFX supervisors who are behind this year's Oscar-nominated films for best visual effects. So we're just so fortunate to have you here with us. Let me just—I have a couple of housekeeping announcements, and then we'll dive in. So yes, I would like to take a moment to thank my incredible team, to thank our partners, the OGR Torino, to thank the VFX Festival in London, Anita and Daniel. And I obviously want to remind everybody about the VIEW Conference coming up this October. Our dates are from the 16th to the 21st of October, and we will be doing a hybrid event. And I hope you will be able to attend in person or online. All right, so let me, before, I really just want to dive in, but let me remind you that we have a couple of previews next week. On Wednesday, we're going to have another panel featuring Oscar contenders, a group of directors and producers behind the best short Oscar contender for best short films. And on Friday, we'll be speaking to the writer and director of Turning Red and some of the key artists on that movie on Friday the 18th. All right, since I know we are eager to dive in, I'm going to turn the floor over to our wonderful moderator, Caroline Giardina, so she can get us started. But I just remember, as I said that, Caroline, I remember that I need to remind the audience to please send in the questions on the platform. So send us all your questions, send them on the platform where you went to see this event, where you registered. Send them now, don't wait until the end. So, you know, with that in mind, I'm just going to turn it over to you. I say thank you to all the wonderful VFX supervisors that are here today. Thank you. Thank you, Paul, Chris, Charlie, and Kelly. And we will bring on board Sven when he appears. He will be there, so he's just a little bit late. Caroline, with that in mind, please take it away. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Maria Elena. Thank you so much for bringing us all together, as always. So, as Maria Elena mentioned, please in the chat ask your questions. We are going to try to cover as many of your questions and as much about these five wonderful nominated films as we can for the next hour. I'd like to start by introducing our guests, the production visual effects supervisors on the five Oscar nominated movies for Best Visual Effects. Let's meet Paul Lambert, Dune. Charlie Noble, No Time to Die. Christopher Townsend, Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings.
Hey.
Kelly Port, Spider-Man, No Way Home. And he's running a few minutes late, but joining us will also be Sven Gilberg for Free Guy. So thanks, everybody, and welcome. For starters, as we all know, these take a village. You all have a lot of people working on these movies, and there's a real global nature to each of your projects. Do each of you just want to take a moment to mention, some key people, suppliers, to give a sense of the scope of the work on some of these? Paul, would you like to start?
Yes, of course. So, the main vendor for Dune was Double Negative, DNEG. We had We split the show where, like, we had a good portion of the show in Vancouver, we had a good portion of the show in Montreal, and we had a good portion of the show in Mumbai. We also had Wiley Co. Come on board after the shoot, and they basically took care of all of the post-viz, and then ended up doing some of the sequences themselves. And then we had Rodeo FX do a handful of some of the establishing shots.
Okay. And Charlie, do you want to take us through No Time to Die?
Yeah, similarly, we had to split our work across a number of facilities. We had a pretty short post period. So we had ILM, Mark Bukowski at ILM, handled a lot of shots. Jonathan Faulkner at Framestore. Joel Green at DNEG. We had Salvador at CineSite. And then we had our own little in-house team from the post office who produced over 200 shots. So they really did some amazing work in not much time.
Christopher?
There were about 1,700-ish visual effects people that worked on Shang-Chi. So it was kind of funny when you look at the number of people on the film versus the entire film, and there was everyone else was about the same number. And then so half of the entire production was visual effects, which was pretty amazing. And we had Weta in New Zealand, Trickster in Germany, Rising Sun in Australia, DD in LA and Vancouver, Scanline in LA and Vancouver, Rodeo in Montreal, Method Melbourne in Melbourne, Australia, Luma in Melbourne, Fin Design in Sydney, Perception in New York, and Stereo D in Canada and India, and a small company called QPPE that did some miscellaneous stuff as well. So it was spread over 12 different vendors and many, many countries.
And Kelly?
Yeah, similar. 12 vendors on Spider-Man, and probably... visual effects hit probably 97% of the film with over 2,500 visual effects shots, probably close to a couple thousand people working on it globally as well. Main vendors were Digital Domain, ImageWorks, Framestore, Luma, Crafty Apes, CineSite, SSVFX, Mars. They all spread around the world in all sorts of different time zones. So is an interesting challenge.
It was a 24/7 job, man, Kelly.
Yeah. Yeah.
So why don't we start with Spider-Man. Kelly, in this movie, you had to create the gateway to the multiverse and bring back characters from previous Spider-Man films, including Doc Ock, Sandman. In some cases, this involved fully CG in the case of Sandman. And you also had to do some de-aging, depending on the time frame that each of them was in. Would you like to start by talking about the key challenges to this project?
Well, one was certainly a respect, stylistic respect for the previous films, and keeping just a ton of research on all of the films where those characters appeared, and wanting to improve those characters, but also, making stylistic continuity with them as well. So that was a challenge just in terms of a research perspective. And, you know, at this point, it's pretty much, you know, a lot of times people ask the question, oh, can you just dig up that old asset? Well, no. Like these things, like, you're lucky if you get something from last week that works, let alone, 8 years ago or whatever. So, you may have a model or something like that, but it's really just a reference for the shape. Software changes. It's just like our iPhone apps, really. Like, it's a good analogy. It's like, oh, well, this app I have from 10 years ago, that should work, right? Well, probably not, you know, as these things change. So just from a technical perspective, it was challenging getting that, all those different characters. But it was really rewarding, too. Because a lot of fans of the previous films, and getting that creatively all in line was really exciting and fun.
Sven, what do you think?
good evening or morning or afternoon to whoever I'm speaking with. I'm so sorry for being late.
No worries. We know how busy you are. Everyone would like to introduce Sven Gilberg, the production visual effects supervisor on Free Guy. Welcome. We're just talking through the five movies, and we're on Spider-Man right now. So,
very good. I'm so sorry I'm late. Anyways, please continue.
No worries. No worries at all. So on the Spider-Man front, which was the most challenging character, and would you elaborate a little bit on the work?
Sandman was probably the most challenging. It's funny.
Case at the time of the original.
Yes. In fact, when we were interviewing the different vendors who had previously worked on it, whether that was a company or individuals, anytime that this was introduced, oh yeah, and we're gonna bring Sandman back, there's this like, oh god, you know, this sort of post-traumatic stress disorder look, you know, across their face. It's like, here we go again, this is not okay. But you know, technology has helped and increased in terms of the power to iterate more and more, and simulations have gotten more sophisticated, certainly. But so I think it was a little bit easier. But still, just even finding a character of the nuances of that, like how much flow and sand do you want? How should he transport from A to B? If he's in a humanoid position, is he going to walk over there? Well, if I was sand, maybe I'd just blow over there. But, you know, it's sort of coming up with that process of character design as well as the technical challenges that accompany it as well, which were pretty big. So I'd probably say, yeah, that one character is probably the most challenging in terms of just the technical side of it, at least.
Mm-hmm. And last night at the Visual Effects Society Awards, you were recognized for the environment, the mirror dimension is what they call it. Would you like to talk about that work?
Sorry, what? I missed the part. Say it one more time.
Oh, the mirror dimension?
Well, Framestore did that work. That was actually a very, very fun creatively, that process, because we wanted to riff on the idea of Doctor Strange 1, mirror dimension, rotating buildings, things like that, that were happening in New York and London. But we also wanted to introduce something fresh, but still stylistically was in tune with the mirror dimension that had already been introduced. So this idea of introducing a hybrid situation where you're introducing the Grand Canyon and the urban environment of Manhattan, I thought could be really visually interesting. On top of that, we were really having a lot of fun playing with portals and all the crazy stuff that you could do with one or more or 10 portals in terms of a chase, and you know, thinking about them as mirrors and what would happen. And it was some real brain teasers in there about how you, like, what happens when you look at a portal from this side, but what is it, what's on the other side if you look at there? And we all had very strong opinions about that. It was a really fun, and went through a lot of different iterations, that sequence. And that was a fun exploration for sure.
What were some of the challenges to, you know, like the CG and, you know, the lighting and, you know, the different aspects of the scene?
Well, certainly the one of the biggest challenges when you have a city or hybrid city canyon, both above and below you, you're having to, you're blocking out of that, a lot of that skylight. So we actually cheated, you know, and created sunlight that was coming in. And it was harsh, you know, daytime, relatively low sunlight, but it was having to kind of cheat that. So, and when it's all CG environment, you're able to cheat some light that's coming through and have it just, okay, I just want the buildings to shadow below, but there's going to be sun coming from above. But you can selectively tweak where exactly that lighting is coming from and find that nice balance so that it works well for everything. Because we wanted those nice raking shadows crossing from buildings onto the terrain below and vice versa. So that was probably the biggest challenge that Framestore faced in creating that.
Okay. So Christopher, let's talk about Shang-Chi. Quite a bit of that work involved the dimension of Talo. And in there, you also created a lot of mystical creatures. Talk about the work.
Yeah, it was Marvel's first Asian-led superhero movie. And we really wanted to play homage to classic Hong Kong and Chinese martial arts films. And the aim was to be totally authentic to that genre in all ways. So in terms of obviously casting and the environments and all the visual effects, the whole look, and also obviously the martial arts fights. There were many martial arts fights in the film. And it was definitely a martial arts movie in that sense. But one of the things that we wanted to do was create very different styles of martial arts and fight sequences. So each character has a very specific way of fighting, and we'll use different styles. And it was very important for all the filmmakers to make that as authentic as possible, which meant that you needed incredibly talented people to do these stunts. Our actors were amazing. They trained for many months and did a lot of the work themselves, but it meant face replacements were a thing. So we have about 250 face replacements in the film. And so that was one of the big sort of things that we didn't really consider going in. We were hoping we'd get more in camera, or we would do short, shaky camera moves, all this kind of stuff. And we wanted to keep, the director was very keen on keeping to the classic, say the Chinese style and the Hong Kong style, which is long camera takes and really allowing your actor to shine. So it made for some complex work in there. But you're right. There's various mythological creatures, including a dragon, and we added some huge digital environments. Talo was one of them. It was about, 30 square miles of massive trees and forests and lakeside mountain, things like this. And it was all, it was not only what, created as a full CG surround, but it was also an asset that was shared with two other companies. So RSP created the asset initially, and then they shared it with both Weta and Trickster, who also had shots in the Talo environment. But there were other environments. There was the forest environment, the bamboo forest environment that we have a car chase through, which comes alive and is a massive sort of simulation, which was a huge thing that Scanline took on. And then water simulations in the end were one thing that really pushed the limits, I think, of Weta. We were very fortunate to have such a massive amount of computing power at our disposal. And I think Sean Walker, the visual effects supervisor at Weta, who was responsible for their work down there, said there was one particular shot which, had it been rendered on a single machine, a single good quality machine, it would have taken 25 years to have actually rendered the shot. So it gives you some idea of complexity. It was absolutely massive. And they had this render wall that we were able to use. So you throw all that together and you've got yourself a little family drama, MCU style. So.
And to go back to Talo, if I remember correctly, because of the pandemic, you weren't able to shoot some of the plates that you had originally intended. So do you want to talk about how you got around that and came up with the environment?
Sure. It's interesting. I get very excited when I go onto these kind of movies because I think I'm going to go to lots of wonderful exotic locations, and I end up not. Although we were shooting in Sydney, Australia, which was pretty amazing. But we ended up shooting everything in Sydney. We were going to go initially to Southeast Asia and do some plate photography and stitch things together. And because of COVID, we weren't able to do that. So we had to build it entirely. So we were using photographic reference of various locations that we liked, and then very carefully art directed it all together and worked very closely with the production designer, Sue Chan. And she built an actual, I think there were a dozen or so houses in the village itself and this amazing set, but it still meant that we had to replace everything beyond. So everything in this full 360 and obviously full aerials was all created. One of the big challenges of shooting in Sydney is that we were blessed with beautiful, sunny blue skies and sunny weather, and which is good for sort of the convenience of shooting. You're not waiting for things to change. But unfortunately, we didn't really want it to be bright and sunny. We wanted it to be cloudy and overcast. So we had massive shadow casters on 350-ton cranes that were suspending these 40-by-60 shadow casters that Bill Pope had orchestrated, our DP. and they would cast these shadows around our main actors, but it meant that everything beyond was brightly lit and often blown out. So there was a lot of incredible comp work having to be done, and also in many cases full background replacements of this beautiful set, which was sort of very, very sad. But it was, unfortunately, I did argue that the case of having Tarlo have square shadows, or rather square clouds in the sky to create square shadows, but they didn't really buy that. So yeah, Tarlo was quite an environment.
And then you also mentioned, you touched on the creatures, including the dragon, but I know there was a lot of research involved and inspirations. Would you talk about that?
Sure. So it's interesting. There are many creatures in this film, from foo dogs, and we have Morris is a six-legged, headless, winged creature. And then we have Chilins and nine-tailed foxes, and then we have the dragon and the dweller in darkness, this massive tentacled beast, and demons and things. So it was tremendous amount of work just in terms of creature work. Weta handled the demons and the dragon and the dweller in darkness, and Trickster handled almost all of the other creatures, including Morris. And I think you always, even though they're mythological, they are based on characters that exist in Asian mythology, and we were very careful to try and keep it as authentic as possible to those characters in terms of the design. But you always want to try and lean into as much reality as possible. So you're looking for, we're looking at Morris, you're looking at a wombat, for instance, and looking at the way that the hares move and how he walks and all that kind of stuff. Or for the Chilin, you're looking at these sort of iridescent horse-like creatures. You're looking at horses, you're looking at parrotfish, you're looking at all these different sort of things. And then for the dragon, we looked at albino lizards and crocodiles, and you're studying the way that, what do the teeth look like, and the tongue and the gums and the claws and the all these different things. And you have to build it as thoroughly as possible. So they've all got full skeletons, which make total physiological sense, and full muscle systems, so that it makes sense when you actually start moving it and animating it, that it feels like a real thing.
Okay, great. Sven, let's get you in here. So for Free Guy, you effectively had three worlds. You had the real world, you had the video game world, and then you had the world that viewers are watching, and some of the character work involved Ryan Reynolds, Guy, and also Dude. So would you talk a little bit about the key challenges on the film?
Sure. As you said, there's three worlds. There's the real world where Taika lives, essentially, directing Tsunami, his video game company. And we shot that on anamorphic lenses, and we did a DI treatment to keep it cold and not very pleasant. And then we have Free City, which we shot on giant format cameras with spherical lenses to keep it poppy, and then we colored it super colorfully and happy. And then we have the video game world, where we went through a huge evolution process on the video game world, where we started it as sort of photoreal, and it was decided that you just couldn't tell you were in a video game when you're looking at the screen. So then we went all the way to cartoony, like Overwatch or Fortnite. And then the audience and Sean, our director, Sean Levy, found that we couldn't empathize with the video game characters. So then we kept pulling them back and back and back towards their own selves, so that you could empathize with Ryan or Channing Tatum or whomever was playing the video game. So that's the three worlds. Some of our bigger challenges were, obviously, the opening shot is 3,000 frames, and that included plates that were shot in Boston and Pittsburgh and on every kind of platform you can ever imagine. I mean, we had drones and Russian arms and two 50-foot super techno cranes on dollies, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We also, Dan Tudyk's team built a super fast 360 motion control rig for the car. And then we filmed that with a robotic camera so that we could go super, super fast because it's a slow motion shot. So anyways, that shot alone took a year and a half. And so we storyboarded it, way ahead of time. Then we pre-vised it the whole time. And so we needed that as a guide in order to just schedule it. Because if you think about it, you've got to shoot Channing's piece at some point, and I have to shoot the car chase first so that we can, pre-program the motion control unit to hook up. And anyways, so it was very complex, and that one was heavily planned. However, working with Sean and Ryan, who are both comedic directors and actors and producers, you really need to think on your feet. You try to plan everything you can, and then that doesn't happen at all. So hopefully you're ready to go for whatever challenges that come. So this movie was super fun to work on, and it had a sense of freedom that I've been doing this for a little while, and we were allowed to pretty much do whatever we wanted. I mean, like our notes to our vendors were literally received with hilarious laughter. Like, I think this shot needs a pterodactyl and a zeppelin with a machine gun and a hot air balloon on fire. And ILM, our team in ILM, in Singapore, our ILM team were, obviously behind our time zone. So they would wake up to notes, and every morning they'd call me and be like, really? I'd be like, yep, that's what we're doing. So it was a super fun process where we weren't really, I tried to keep it all grounded and tried to keep it real-ish, but anything went. So it was a passion project, super fun to make, and hopefully everyone enjoyed it as much as we did making it.
And who were the vendors on it?
ILM, Scanline, Digital Domain, Lola, Creative Cantina, Perception. I'm going to miss a few.
Okay. And one of the questions in from our viewers asks, there are tons of funny visual effects gags. Which ones made you laugh the most while you were creating them?
I think that one's fairly easy. That would be Ryan's antithesis. That's a hard word. Which was the history on Ryan versus Dude is this. I did a Night Museum 3 with Ryan, and we did Larry versus Law, which were both played by Ben Stiller. And at that time, we did it with motion control. And so early in pre-production, Sean said, I really don't want to do that again. So he gave me the challenge of doing multiple talking face replacements. And so, which makes all of us in this group a little nervous because they can get uncanny pretty quickly. And so, Ryan decided that he wanted to be a 350-pound, 6'8", muscle-bound character as Dude. So that made it another challenge. So our second unit director, Chris O'Hara, literally Googled giant Dude, and we came up with this guy's picture. And I was like, that guy goes to my gym. And we hired him, and his name was Aaron Reed, and he was great. But so in pre-production, I did a test with Dan Stevens, Ryan's stunt double at Lola. And so we went and filmed a bunch of talking face expressions and built our confidence around it. And we used Lola's process, which I really like because it's photographic, meaning it's not an animator interpreting some performance of an actor. It's actually the actor's performance. And it actually, with Sean and Ryan, enabled us to riff. So even in post-production, we changed tons and tons of lines on Dude's character. So anyways, he was the most funny and most entertaining to me.
Okay. Let's go to No Time to Die, 25th Bond film, and last one, which Daniel Craig. Charlie, you, I mean, as in all of the Bond films, you're creating some really interesting action sequences and in a variety of environments. I know one of the more challenging ones you had said was the car chase when they leave the safe house in Norway. Do you want to describe the collection of practical and digital effects that you used to create that sequence?
Yeah, those. I mean, one thing that really struck me when I started this film was just the overarching desire to get as much as possible in camera. To that end, Lee Morrison, the stunt coordinator, and Chris Corbold, special effects supervisor, traveled to Scotland a number of times to recce and to choreograph that chase, which ended up taking place over, I think, 8 locations, 2 different countries. So for each, handover from one location to the next, we're obviously taking elements from outgoing shots and putting them into incoming shots all the way through. The chase starts in Ascot, and there was a small partial set build there for the house itself, which we extended out, stripped in some of the environment that we'd seen earlier on from the pre-title sequence, and then the chase, takes us along the Atlantic Highway in Norway, and then off onto River Loch in Scotland, up onto the hills in Scotland, another location, through a foggy forest in Ascot, and then back up to Scotland for the end when Safin flies off in the helicopter. And so for that chase through the river in Scotland, Lee had constructed a series of ramps and a track for camera vehicles and the vehicles to travel down, so that the action was as sort of as repeatable as possible, really. But obviously, that all that track's there for a reason, so that you don't do one take and you end up with 10 vehicles all stuck in the mud. So we had to construct quite a bit of stuff, and then that meant that we had to then replace all that with CG terrain. And once we got into the edit, there were certain shots where we needed to tell the story better. We needed to swap out all the vehicles and replace them with CG ones. So we've got CG vehicles, CG terrain. We're adding in Atmos. Just a whole bunch of things going on there. And some shots ended up being all CG. But obviously we're building on pretty solid foundations from what was achieved practically. So, if one camera had missed a shot that we wanted, there was always another camera that had seen it, so we could then copy that with for our CG work and we're creating CG vehicles. So we were lucky in that regard. But having Chris, this is my second Bond film. My first was GoldenEye a long time ago, but it was great having Chris Corbold. Working so close with Chris Corbold, special effects supervisor, who I think this is his 15th Bond. So, a vast amount of experience, and I was so lucky to be working with him on this. But Framestore did an amazing job on that chase, and it really incorporated a bunch of approaches. We had obviously the picture cars doing the wide stuff, and driven by world rally champ, well, 3-time world rally champion Mark Higgins. And whenever we saw him, we obviously had to take him out and put Daniel and Leia into the Hero Land Cruiser. And then when we get closer, we've got the real cast in the vehicle itself being driven at speed by a pod driver, well, Mark back up on the roof in a pod. So we're having to paint that out. And then when we jump even closer to any of the dialogue inside the car, we'd recorded all of the vehicle's motion from each location with little IMU devices. And we took that data and then used it to drive the six-axis, one of Chris's six-axis gimbals. So we took the engines out of the cars and mounted them on the gimbals, drove gimbals with the actual data from the locations. So they were thrown about exactly as they would have been on location. Then we surrounded those vehicles with a 270 LED screen to give us interactive lighting. So, you know, keeping it as real as possible. I think that was the thing for all of our work. We Bond's a real human, so it was important for us to for everything to be based on reality. And to that degree, you know, the stunts, all the, lots of real stunts, people jumping off bridges and doing massive free bike jumps. And so that obviously ended up with needing a lot of face replacements and body replacements sometimes. But yeah, all grounded in reality, which was really great for me to be working with.
One of the questions was about when James jumps off the bridge. Do you want to elaborate on that one?
Yeah, I mean, that's an amazing stunt on location. So with that sequence, we it was actually shot in two separate locations. So whenever we were on the bridge location, we were having to strip in Matera, the Italian town around it. And obviously when we were in Matera, we were bringing the bridge to Matera. But yeah, that bridge was a real jump off that bridge. Obviously, we got some couple of huge cranes either side of the bridge to hold the lines for the stunt jumper. And then we, well, ILM handled all that stuff, but and then we had to add a the cord that he's holding on to that he grabs when he jumps off the bridge. That's added in later on. And then we're replacing some bits of body and obviously faces as we, and heads as he swings down. And then we take over to Daniel landing on the ground at the end. But an amazing free jump. Yeah, stunning.
Okay. Well, let's move on to Paul and Dune. Paul, I mean, there was a lot of environment work you had to create, you know, Arrakis, its capital, Arakeen, lots of sand, and then, of course, the sandworms. Tell us about the most challenging aspects of Dune, which I know was also about doing as much in camera as possible, too.
Yes. So, like, you know, like the goal from the very outset, and this is true for any production, is to try and keep things as photoreal and as grounded as possible, and I had a director who isn't a big fan of blue screen, but he knows that I also have to do my job. So like, if I tell him that, you know, I need the blue screen, he's not going to start stamping his feet and say, no. But so going into the project, knowing his sensibilities meant that like, we just had to try and think of things in a slightly different way. And like, we spent 6 months in pre-production in Budapest, coming up with a range of different ideas to like try and approach the different scenarios we had. And we knew that like we had to create all these different worlds, but like our main one was going to be Arrakis and Arrakeen. And you know, in keeping with like trying to keep everything trying to keep things in camera, knowing that we also are trying that, like we're also working on a sci-fi movie with like spaceships, with these huge alien worlds, you know, like it was trying to come up with the processes to like try and make that believable. So like things like Arrakeen in Arrakis is actually based on a particular area in Wadi Rum. Like we all got into a helicopter, flew over various sections of the actual desert there, and like it was on one particular approach that like Denis saw the area in which like he wanted Arrakeen to be. So then like I then had clear angle spend like a good couple of months out in Jordan actually scanning and like doing like photogrammetry and they had like a drone and like capturing all of these areas so that we could then build them back in the computer to then add the CG city. And that was actually that I was told recently that like the amount of time which went into that asset was like 15% of the entire time on the actual movie. So like it was a massive undertaking, you know. And one thing which like we did come up with in line with Denis not wanting to use a blue screen was like we came up with the idea of a sand screen as well for anything in Arrakis. And there was a multitude of reasons as to why that actually worked out well for us, because you know when you watch the movie now, there will be shots where like you see the visors on the Harkonnen soldiers, or like you see a very diffuse reflection on the Atreides armor, and some of those shots aren't visual effect shots, but then you still get a sense of desert, or like you get a reflection of like a sand color and a sky. And that's basically just the sand screen from the backlot surrounding the sand screen on the backlot actually being reflected in the visors and in the ornithopters and in the Atreides suit. So you know, like it gave the benefit of capturing stuff in camera, which like otherwise would have been a visual effect shot. Like if I'd made that all blue, I would have to process that in some particular way, whether it be as a visual effect shot or in DI. Another thing which it did was that like it immersed the characters in that particular color. So, you know, like the idea was very straightforward in that like anything which we were going to be replacing was going to be sand colored. You know, it was either going to be a slice of Arrakeen or it was going to be desert. So, you know, it just felt like the right idea. And like the cool thing about it was that like in like testing this stuff, because I actually brought two visual effects artists out with me during pre-production, and it's something which I'm going to continue to do, because what it allowed us to do was to do some really quick fire tests on the set, like instant tests where like I could then show the director, which then informed us about how we could shoot those particular things. So, you know, because like I think we've all been in a situation in that like you want a test done, you go to the facility, and you know it needs to be scheduled, it needs time, and by the time you get something back, the director's moved on, and like he wants to try something else. So, you know, having that instant feedback was really valuable, because it was there where like we came up with the ideas for the hologram, where like we came up for the idea of the interior ornithopter work. You know, like traditionally, like you would either put the ornithopter inside of a studio and like surround it with a blue screen, and then like shoot all of your material from inside the ornithopter. But what we figured out was that if we took our buck, our gimbal and buck, and we went to the highest hill outside of Budapest and set up there, we then like surrounded the gimbal with a 25 foot ramp in like a sand color. So again, it was like a sand screen going all the way around the gimbal angled. The idea being that on a hot day in Budapest, on a hot sunny day in Budapest, you would get the light bounce off that ramp and into the ornithopter. And like just like watching the footage at the Video Village as we were shooting this, and Greg, our DOP, would be focused on Paul or Gurney, and like the like rest of the background was out of focus. It actually felt that you were flying in the desert, because everything was out of focus, but then like you had all the right tones and it felt like a hot desert day. What the compass then did was like we also shot hours of footage in the United Arab Emirates from a helicopter using an array of just flying over dunes. Hours and hours of it. And so what the compositors did was then do a blend with the original footage rather than trying to do a full-on extraction where, like, you would probably have to rebuild the reflections and everything else. It was more of a blend. It was more of a composited job as to come up with ways in which to seamlessly blend everything together. And I was really happy with, like, how things came out because it felt as if, like, you were in this really hot environment, you know, this hot desert environment, and, like, you were basically out in Budapest. And, you know, and the movers that... The actual movie is peppered with all these different techniques, which come down to the collaboration on this particular movie. I've never been involved in a production where it's been so collaborative from every single HOD, you know, and like everybody here can say that, like, you know, like they've been on films where like you get something shot and then like you just have to fix it in post because like. You hear that word. I never once heard fix it in post because everybody was pushing to like get the best possible output. And you know, I touched on the hologram sequence as well. That was something in which I was faced with the challenge of like having to create a CG Timothy Chalamet. Now we did make him for like some more of the distance work, but I was a little bit anxious about like doing something which was going to be full screen, you know, like, you know, having done this kind of work before, I know how long it takes, how hard it is and how expensive it is. So I wanted to investigate using different ways in to actually try and do this. And what we came up with was we had developed an interactive tracking process on set where like we were able to work out where Paul was in the set. We had already finalized the CG bush with Denise, so like we actually had a buy-off already like really early on, which is amazing just in itself. Like we were still in a pre-production and like I had an approved asset already. But so what we did with this holographic bush is that we sliced it into hundreds of cross-sectional slices of the bush. We then got a real projector, and we would project each slice onto Timothy based on where he was in the scene. So basically, whenever he moved, a different slice would then be projected on him, and then whenever he moved again, a different slice would be projected on him. And that gave the impression of him interacting with the branches and actually moving with the hologram. So what was then done in post was then just adding the CG bush in front of him and behind him, and basically what I was left with, what I was able to capture on scene was like the perfect interactive light, you know, on Paul. Sorry, Carolyn,
I'm just watching the clock. So, but finish your thought. I mean, that was an interesting sequence.
So yes, that was how we got that particular process.
It was a very interesting sequence. I'm going to try to get through as many questions as possible in the time we have left. There are a few about deep fakes and. I know at least one of you used artificial intelligence and machine learning on your character work. Does someone want to start that conversation?
Sure, I'll start. As we did it, actually use it a fair bit. We, for our face replacements on Shang-Chi, we did a combination of traditional, you know, compositing 3D CG heads, but we also did deepfake. And I read one of the questions, is there a future in it? And I absolutely think there is. One of the interesting things about deepfake technology and machine learning, AI, is that your character, your performance is driven by the stunt performer. And going into this project, that had always been a big no-no for me. I'd been like, no, well, you don't want that. You want it to be driven by the actor. You don't want it to be driven by the stunt performer. But the reality is, I think most of the time when face replacements are being done, if it's not a dramatic moment, but it's an action moment, you actually want that relationship, that direct relationship between the face and the body and what the face and the body do together. So when you get that for in, you know, live action, when you're actually shooting your stunt performer and you get that reaction and the intensity and the aggression or whatever it may be, and you get that natural reaction. And that's what I think makes the face replacement so much more believable when a deep fake is used. It's not a plug and play technique by any means. It's an incredible amount of work. Of training machines, but also artistry. You only get the face, you don't get the face shape, and you don't get the jawline and anything else. So there's an awful lot of manipulation still required. But yeah, I think there's definitely a future.
Yeah, I use it also online, and I will definitely be using it in the future. To elaborate, here we go. One of our video game characters, as I said, we started Photoreal and then we went into a cartoony world, and our director, Sean, felt the audience wasn't empathizing with the character. So Channing Tatum's character was a digi-double that was not designed to talk. And we used deepfakes to make his character talk, and everyone was happy with the results, and we'll definitely be using it in the future. Mm.
Yeah, we didn't really use it on No Time to Die. We used ILM's Medusa rig and Anima rig, which allows you to move around and perform. So, we had the cast into those sessions, and so they could watch what the stunts were doing, but then they could, you know, it was their performance that was coming through on the digi doubles or the faces. So, I think which they really quite enjoyed doing actually. And seeing the results was pretty amazing from ILM. They did a lot of great work on the heads.
Yeah, and I agree with Charlie that having the actual actor's performance makes such a big difference. So Lola also has a great facial capture rig, and we used it at length.
Yeah, I think deepfake and more broadly AI in general, as that progresses over the next 5 to 10 years, is going to be enormously helpful for visual effects artists and technicians, just to help their what they already do. Like Chris was saying, it's still a lot of manual labor and artistry involved in, like painstaking artistry often, to get these things integrated and looking correct. But I think AI tools broadly will develop probably quite exponentially, in my view, in the next 5 to 10 years, that will just, I think we're all going to be very surprised about how and what particular departments they're going to find themselves really excelling in. But I think it's just going to help the artists, you know, get to the final result sooner.
I totally agree. You know, like I think AI is going to touch every single aspect of like visual effects. Like I recently did a test where like I took like some of the blue eye work from the first movie, and like I used that as a training set. So basically, I took all the shots, which like we like painstakingly rotoscoped the eyeballs, and turned blue, and did this is what it was, this is what it became. Trained it for a good amount of time, and then put in some brand new imagery, and it worked. It actually worked. I suddenly got blue eyes on people in which so, you know, like I think there are, you know, I think it's going to touch every single aspect of what we do. And the goal of it is to be able to add artist friendly tools to it, because right now a lot of it is like a black box. You know, you put it in and it comes out and you have no control of it. When going into a production, that's actually quite scary. So like the more research is done to be able to give a human touch onto what the processes are doing is how our industry is going to be defined.
Most of you finished your movies during the pandemic, which I'm sure involved new techniques or tools out of necessity. Was there anything that you used that you could talk about that kind of gave you clues as to how you're going to work or what you want to use or do differently in the future?
What I found, because like we had shot like we had finished shooting and we were into post. And what I found is that I actually, because I was working from home rather than being in a screening room every day, I actually had more time with the imagery. And you know, looking back at it now, I almost became a composite again. You know, like actually getting the finals in, and then having a look at the plates, A/B, and going through, giving notes, because you know, up until the pandemic, I would always be in a screening room with a pointer pointing out any of the obvious, but I actually felt myself getting much closer to the imagery and catching things which I may not have caught on the big screen. It's still imperative to review things on the big screen, and like that's what I did as well. You know, like once a week we would then isolate into about two or three screens and review that way. But it is something which I am going to take on into the future and get back into, like actually getting a little bit closer to the imagery rather than just having something flash up in front of me a couple of times, swing a laser pointer, make a note, and then just you know, like final on it. So yeah, so it did have a positive effect to how I work.
Yeah, I think the work from home thing. Sorry,
go, please.
I was just going to say, you know, I agree. I think working from home has got obviously plus and minuses. Where you lose that sort of water cooler hallway meetings, bumping into someone in the hallway, and you just casually talk about something and you riff on like each other's ideas. So you certainly lose that. And I think we're going to have to try and find a way of being able to create more accessible video conferencing tools that are, you know, you can just pop in. I mean, you obviously can do it now, but we have to get used to working that way. And I agree with what Paul was saying. I'm getting closer to the imagery. One of the things that I was thinking about, what happened during the pandemic, we use mannequins. Shang-Chi was shut down in the middle of a big nightclub scene where we had 400 extras. Pandemic hit and everyone was told to go home. And then when we came back 3 months later to continue shooting, we were only allowed, I think, 50 people on the set at the same time. And so we talked about how do we do this? Do we do it in crowds? And we do multiple passes. And I said, how about we get some mannequins? So we got 80 mannequins that we dressed and we placed them in the shadows and we put people, you know, next to them. And they were just standing around and they were in these, you know, fixed poses. And they're in the movie. And you know, people were saying, "No way, you're not gonna make it work." And I was like, yeah, "You made it work. It looks good." I mean, you know, so if you look closely, you can see some people who aren't actually moving very much, and that's because they're not real. Brilliant. So we did multiple passes as well, but it was kind of a fun part, one of the fun things that we did.
Brilliant. Sven, did you have anything you wanted to add?
Yeah, all I was going to say was, we finished our movie a long time ago, and it was not released, you know, because of the pandemic. So, but we shot pre-pandemic, and then we just started heavy post when the first lockdown happened. And what amazed me was how strangely ready we all were. Like we moved 1400 artists indoors in 9 days, and the studio is going to shut us down, and I fought really hard to not shut us down because there's 1400 people that were being employed at the time, and I didn't want them to not be employed, and we just did it, and it's like you could not have done it 2 years ago, I mean, 3 years ago, like between Zoom and our internet connections, I was just blown away by how we did it in 9 days, and all of a sudden we were producing shots. And you should see my office, it's bananas. Like, and I think we're all there, like we have huge monitors everywhere, like gigabit internet connections and massive raids. And so I was blown away by how quickly we adapted. Anyways. My piece.
I was pretty fortunate in a way that we delivered on time, and the very next day we were told that we were going into lockdown. So the film then sat on the shelf off for 18 months, delayed a number of times. But while, you know, Barbara and Michael held out for a theatrical release, for which we're all really grateful for, to see our work showcased on the big screen. So, you know, it was a long time waiting, but I'm glad that they did hold out.
Yeah, I think it's going to be interesting. You talk to a lot of the visual effects studios and you hear sort of anecdotal evidence of like this particular company did really, really well. Most of them were actually able, like Sven was saying, able to adapt to this new work from home scenario, like incredibly quickly, really on their own resources too, deploying remote work situations, technically, all the stuff that's involved with that. But what's really interesting is just seeing how some companies, anyway, just discover that a lot of this is actually more productive than they were in the office. And then some people really like it. Some people really hate it. And so it's mm-hmm. going to be really interesting. I think the consensus opinion that I'm just getting from people generally is that it's going to end up being a hybrid type situation that we're going to take. You know, maybe it's not going in every single day. A lot of companies, by the way, expanded dramatically during this time too, in terms of their workforce. And even if they wanted to go back home at this point, they couldn't. Like, they're like, they don't have enough seats to physically put everybody back to the offices.
The seats are gone.
Or they're gone. Like, we don't even have that building anymore. So,
I go to the facilities now and find like, there's no seats left.
But there's certain aspects to what we do that are critical and need a big screening room, or like Chris was saying, you know, it's great to have that cross pollination when you're meeting with somebody in the kitchen and having coffee that you're not even on the same show and you're just talking about similar problems that you're potentially working on independently. And then you just have this kind of happenstance conversation that like, we could do that too. You know, those are the kind of things that we are missing in this situation. But yeah, I think it'll be a hybrid in the long run.
Quickly add, like I did all of Free Guy remotely in post, and the current movie we shot for independent, but I'm in heavy, heavy post right now. And we have chosen to go back into the office. So we work in the office every day, and it's completely optional. But it's so nice to see the people that you work with and have those chats at the water cooler or whatever.
Yeah.
We only have a couple of minutes left, and then we're going to have to wrap. But I'm going to try to squeeze in one more question, if anyone has a short answer to this one. One of our viewers asked, in terms of production and aesthetics, and actually I would add, and tools, how much are video games and cinema merging?
Sven, you should take that one first.
I'll take it even though I have the wrong answer. They're merging. They're merging quickly, but not quite as quickly as people think, in my opinion. The Unreal Engine is amazing, and it will be there very, very soon. It wasn't there for my last picture. I think it's all coming together. The real-time rendering hasn't quite hit it yet, but it's about to. So that's my 2 cents. Please, guys. You've all seen it.
I totally agree. They're converging. They've been converging for about 30 years. It's not even necessarily, it's getting more rapid as these things happen. And I think what we mean by the question, I think, is that when is this game technology, whether it's real-time rendering or game engine technology, going to be used for visual effects in movies? And I think it already is to some extent, certainly in pre-visualization and other techniques, that's starting to get deployed, in LED walls and things like that, with more or less success, but it's sort of happening, and I think it'll continue to happen, but, it is a different world and a lot more precision and thought goes into the non-real-time stuff that we do, that, you know, I think it will always be a tool, and it is a tool, but that's kind of my view on it.
Okay. Well, I wish we had hours to talk about all of your movies and to answer everybody's questions, but unfortunately we have limited time and we're up. But thank you, all of you, for sharing your thoughts and your stories about your movies. Congratulations on all of your movies, and enjoy the next few weeks during this award season. Maria Elena, as always, thank you so much for putting this together. Yeah, and we look forward to seeing you soon in person.
Thank you, girl.
Thanks very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
Thanks, everybody.
Good to see everyone. I'll see you real soon.
Yeah. Bye.